No, Jason, weirder. That's it, perfect.
This is my alter ego. Dave Proxima was the supervising animator of the gargoyles, Hugo and Victor. Hey, Dave, how do you guys come up with the character design in Disney animation?
We get our inspiration from you guys, the voice talent. You know, how you sound and how you look.
Thanks a lot, Dave. Why don't we take a look inside Disney's new animation building and see where these stars were born? Looks nothing like me. I don't have wings. This is the brand new feature animation building at the Walt Disney Studios. The Disney Feature Animation Building is a three-story, 243,000 square foot building that provides a creative environment for all of the artists, animators, and technicians who work on Disney animated films. In fact, Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame was the very first animated feature to be produced at the new building.
And the great thing about it is we're all under one roof. So you can run upstairs and have a story meeting, you can run downstairs and look at film, run across the hall and have lunch. And with that comes a great stew of creativity happening. It gives a chance for people to get away from the drawing board for a few hours and go out and blow off some steam.
The making of Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame was a huge undertaking of international proportions. Disney's team of 100 artists and animators at the Disney Animation Studio in Paris contributed about 10 minutes of animation to the film and added an element of authenticity.
When you come into a city that is thousands of years old and you walk into structures that were built 700 years ago, you get that depth of feeling that there were a lot of people through here before you.
The novel's author, Victor Hugo, lived just a few miles from the studio, about 165 years ago. Great name, by the way, Victor Hugo. Meanwhile, back at Disney's feature animation building, Victor Hugo's classic characters were being transformed into the animated marvels that populate Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Quasimodo's supervising animator was veteran character artist James Baxter, who supervised the creation of such characters as Belle in Beauty and the Beast and Rafiki in The Lion King.
He had to be strong in a compact way, like a little wrestler or something, like a guy that you'd really feel his grip if he got you, but he's not very tall.
What a woman!
What a woman, indeed. Demi's voice was a wonderful inspiration for the look of the character Esmeralda. But actually animating her with her gypsy wardrobe and jewelry was a little less fun.
She has a lot of stuff on her. She has a big shock of hair and a big earring that flops around and stuff. There's a lot to watch in terms of emotion. Yeah, it's pretty challenging.
Hey, isn't that Feeble?
Dofus.
Phoebus!
Now, I'm not the jealous type, but look at this guy. His name is Phoebus, Captain of the Guards. Big deal. He gets in fights with everybody, even Esmeralda.
Are you always this charming, or am I just lucky?
This is Russ Edmonds, supervising animator of Phoebus, giving his team of animators a motivational talk. It looks like Russ has their attention.
You were saying?
Phoebus is a rectangle. If you picture his shoulders, he's broad. He's the first Disney hero to have facial hair. It squares off his jaw nicely.
They leave town for a couple of decades and they change everything.
He's very human. Throughout the show, he gets beat up and he always makes a joke about it. Esmeralda hits him, Quasi hits him, Goat hits him, gets shot in the arm, gets thrown off a bridge. But he always comes through with a joke.
Great, I could use a drink.
That's just his character.
Yes! Feels like a 1470 Burgundy. Not a good year.
You know, my last Captain of the Guard was a bit of a disappointment to me.
Say hello to Disney's latest bad guy. He's Minister of Justice, Claude Frollo. The supervising animator of Frollo is Kathy Zielinski, who is, in fact, a very nice person. So how did she bring a worm like Frollo to life?
Oh, I love my character.
The sentence for insubordination is death. Such a pity.
He's the best villain I've ever worked on, and I'm just so tickled being able to do such an evil person.
Stop.
Sir.
He's up. Wait between lashes. Otherwise, the old sting will dull him to the new.
All right. Now we're talking. Here's the real star of the movie, me. Hugo's the name. Gargoylin's the game. That's right.
Hugo is the shorter, fatter, more robust of the two.
What are you saying exactly?
Supervising animator Will Finn was the team leader on Laverne.
Laverne the Gargoyle is sort of the wisdom speaker of the trio of gargoyles that we've given to Quasimodo as pals.
Quasi, take it from an old spectator. Life's not a spectator sport.
Dave Kruxma was not just the supervising animator on Hugo, king of all gargoyles. Dave was also supervising animator on Victor.
Ignorance is bliss.
Look who's talking.
Victor is always a beat behind Hugo because Hugo's just like, go out there and do it. And Victor is very reserved.
Well, that's what you get for sleeping with your mouth open.
Go scare a nun. Everyone who's ever read Victor Hugo's original novel knows that the talking gargoyles were the central characters. No, really the real heroes of the story. They're funny, cute, clever. And there is absolutely no question that the three gargoyles in Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame will become the most beloved characters in the history of Disney animation. Hello? Yes, this is Jason Alexander. Uh-huh. Yes, I said that the gargoyles were going to be Disney's greatest characters. Who has a problem with that? Who wants to talk to me? Who's coming right over? A mouse, a duck, and a dog. That case. Animation facts. Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame utilized the talents of 620 artists, production, and technical staff, who in turn devoured over 72,000 pencils, 1 million sheets of animation paper, and spent 1.2 million work hours to create Disney's 34th animated feature. Also during that time, they consumed over 2,000 bags of potato and tortilla chips, not to mention pretzels. Quasimodo's home, high in a massive bell tower on top of Notre Dame Cathedral, is depicted in the film much the same way Victor Hugo described it in the original novel. In 1831, Victor Hugo wrote this epic tale by hand, most likely by candlelight. Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame was inspired by Victor Hugo's original work, but many of the film's special effects were produced using Disney's award-winning state-of-the-art technology, housed in well-lit, fully air-conditioned computer rooms. This gave them a decided advantage because they could actually see what they were doing. First, let's see how Disney artists create the environments that our characters inhabit.
We darken these columns down a little bit.
Right, when we saw this on film.
Art director Dave Getz and his team were responsible for setting the look or the visual tone of the film.
When we went to Paris, found out more about what Victor Hugo was doing, and then actually saw not only the book illustrations, but his own illustrations, and we thought, okay, maybe we're on the right track.
The character is walking down the street and split the levels up so that we can get a multiplane feel.
Layout supervisor Ed Gertner and background supervisor Lisa Keene literally set the stage for the drama and emotion of Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Head of layout works with the directors and the art director in trying to set the mood and the locales of the picture, trying to create this world that Quasi's going to live in. From the storyboards, we create the staging and we put in the sets for the characters.
And when it comes to background, we give it the atmosphere, its emotional color sense. You find key moments within the movie, and what you're doing is trying to establish, does this feel the way you want that scene to look? If you have a very hostile, angry scene, you're not going to be putting very pastel, muted colors in that sequence. You want something very rich and vibrant and exciting and dramatic.
One great thing about animation is there's no boundaries. You can take the animation camera anywhere your imagination wants to go.
Most of the special effects shots in feature animation serve the same purpose as a music underscore. The audience may not be aware of them, but they are essential for creating a sense of reality. You may not give any thought to shadows in a live-action film, but there's a big difference between live-action and animation. In animation, somebody has to draw the shadows or plan a computer-rendered background moving in the right perspective one frame at a time.
A Disney animated film is not a Disney animated film without the effects. It's been told before that effect shot is anything where the character doesn't appear. However, an effect shot, particularly in Hunchback, is much, much more than that. It adds atmosphere and life and believability. the big rose window effect shot where Esmeralda sort of tentatively walks into the pool of light created by the rose window. And we're doing the dust particles to suggest the silence of the place.
Disney's Academy Award-winning technology has helped animators create spectacular shots that would have been impossible to achieve a few years ago. For instance, in Disney's The Lion King, a rampaging stampede of wildebeests was created by Disney's computer-generated imagery, or CGI department. For Hunchback of Notre Dame, animators wanted to create big Ben-Hur-like crowds to fill the streets of Paris.
I think the cavalry's here!
CGI, under the direction of CGI supervisor Kiran Joshi, developed a way to create huge crowds like you've never seen before in an animated film. First, the animators create a character model and define the character's movements. Then, they scramble the basic character's look by adding different clothing, beards, or mustaches. It's the same image, but with different accessories. Then, the CGI animator uses the computer to multiply the images and choreograph them onto various parts of the shot, and basically creates a teeming mob of townspeople and a breathtaking effect that has never been seen before in an animated film.
Walt Disney left us this great legacy, which is technological advancement. With every movie, the first sound cartoon, the first feature-length animated feature was Snow White, the use of the multiplane camera. And this generation of animators has picked up on that, and so you see tremendous advancements with the use of computer graphics and technology to bring these movies to the screen.
Whatever's good for you.
Creating the characters and the world they live in is only part of the story. All Disney animated features have a rich musical score that fills them with emotion. And Disney's 34th animated feature is no exception.
Just to live one day out there.
The Hunchback of Notre Dame reunites the Academy Award-winning team that created the music for Disney's Pocahontas, composer Alan Menken and lyricist Stephen Schwartz. The Hunchback of Notre Dame has 8 new songs, each supporting an important part of the story in a unique way.
Once a year we throw a party here in town. Once a year we turn all parties upside down.
If I was in their skin, I'd treasure every instant.
Some say the soul of the city is the toll of the band.
The bells of Notre Dame.
To further add to the mood and atmosphere of Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame, Don Hahn, Gary Trousdale, and Kirk Wise traveled to London with Alan Menken and Stephen Schwartz for a very special recording session featuring members of the English National Opera Company and a 100-year-old pipe organ. Broadway star Heidi Mollenhauer is the singing voice of Esmeralda.
Less lucky than I.
And the challenge really was to be able to release all that this song made me feel. I mean, I get choked up every time, you know, I talk about it because I just think it's such a beautiful moment.
Of God. God help the outcast. Children of God.
It's been an adventure for all of us, but I certainly intend to be a part of it for a long time.
There's some kind of unwritten and unspoken agreement between those of us who are making the films and the audience. And the audience wants us each time to push it someplace where it hasn't gone before.
Disney has a tremendous commitment to telling great stories, which I think is the fundamental principle of animation, telling it with great characters, and always pushing the sort of artistic boundaries of animation always one step further.
One of the things that keeps us honest is Snow White, Pinocchio, Bambi, Fantasia. That history that is part of our tradition, that keeps our sights awfully, awfully high.
Wow. Working on Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame was an unforgettable experience. I hope I've helped you learn a little bit about the process of animation and all the hard work it takes to produce an animated feature, especially one like this. So on behalf of myself and Hugo, we'd just like to say that... Hey, could you hold it down out there? I'm trying to talk here. Excuse me.
Boy, this is unacceptable.
Jason Alexander, we've got to talk. You know, man to mouse. Goofy, watch the back.
Got you covered.
Donald, check the windows.
Okay, McGee.
On behalf of myself and Hugo, just like to say thanks for watching.
Jason, open up. I know you're in there. I can hear you breathing. Now you can't stay in there forever, you know. Jason.